Welcome to your life. There's no turning back. Even while we sleep, we will find you acting on your best behavior. Turn your back on Mother Nature. Everybody wants to rule the world.
I'm author Edwin F. Becker. I wrote a book called True Haunting that became a worldwide sensation. It amazed me, amazed my family, but it took the paranormal world by surprise, because what I didn't realize was that it chronicled and recorded the first paranormal event ever televised by NBC in 1971. Before The Exorcist, before Amityville, before all the horrific images, came True Haunting. It was initially written as more or less a recording for my family in a diary. And it was my daughter that decided to put it out on the market. And it was accepted and embraced by the paranormal community immediately. Why? I mean, I was scratching my head as to why, because I don't watch cable television. I don't know of all the various programs that are available. I didn't know the celebrities. I did not know the acronyms of EVP and EMF. So it was with great surprise that the book went worldwide and became a number one for a year on Amazon's Kindle, and number one for 6 months in the UK, and now travels the top 10 in Australia and other countries. What is true haunting? It's the absolute truth about how ghosts can move into your life. They do not come screaming out of the closet and scare you and say boo. They're very subtle, and they sense your instincts and who you are, and they react accordingly. They definitely will work at separating you from your relationships and creating agitation and a negative energy that they can feed off of, which is what my book talks about. It tells a story of my wife and I, who were young and naive, who bought a building that was inhabited by a number of spirits. Some of the spirits were good and benign, which most spirits are. A few of them were not benign, they were malevolent, and they created havoc in our life. Now, I have no stories to tell about a pig head flying through the air, or a flaming skeleton swinging from the ceiling. What ghosts do is they do subtle little things. They move things so that you'll walk into a room and you'll find that the item that you thought you left on a cabinet is now on your dresser. And you'll start to question your own behavior. Did I do that? Did my wife do that? Typically, you rationalize and justify that movement. Then you start to lose things, where things suddenly disappear. You can't find them. And they're things that typically you put in a certain place, such as your wallet or your keys, and you know where they're supposed to be at, but they're not there. And of course, in my book, I chronicle how a husband's first instinct is to say, "Wife, what did you do with it? Where'd you put it?" And of course she would deny it. And that would create a tension and a friction that these things love to do. They're very, very subtle and how they start to take their control over your movement and over your personality. Ours became more active with my wife because she was a believer. In my book and in reality, I was not a believer in ghosts. To me, we had no images in 1970 for what spirits should look like. To me, they were Casper the Friendly Ghost. They were the Canterville Ghost. They were the handsome dude on The Ghost of Mrs. Muir. They weren't frightening. So therefore, I was never, ever afraid until much later on, when I realized I was dealing with an energy that was unpredictable and that I couldn't estimate its power. I soon found out that if it can move items like a broom, or it took our hand mixer and propelled it off the wall, I wasn't sure how big the items it could move. Pretty soon you start to wonder, could it move the refrigerator? Could it move doors, pots and pans? It eventually moved and propelled dishes. Many of these things are common with ghostly behavior. Now, once my book came out, I received emails from all over the world. And as this series continues, once I finish talking about True Haunting and True Haunting 2, the soon-to-be-released sequel, I will talk about ghostly activity that people have experienced in other countries and how some of the activity is so common that you learn that most of these spirits were people. And what they do in the afterlife many times mirrors what they did in real life. They move cabinets. They open doors. They walk the hallways. They knock. They sometimes make audible sounds. They might even call your name. But most of it is actually harmless. If you have no fear and you do not address it nor interface with it, you can exist and coexist with that dimension. However, there's a dark side where a ghost has a strong sense of domain. And if you enter that domain or violate its territory, it will react unpredictably. In the case of a friend of ours, he had a television set. He placed it in a certain part of his old house in the living room, and he couldn't get the remote to work. And the remote would sometimes work, sometimes it wouldn't work. And I explained to him that if that's all the activity he had, that he was likely invading a spirit's territory. I told him, move the television, simply move it to the other side of the room, which he did do. Never had a problem after that. And that's how 90% of ghostly activity can be dealt with. The other 10% becomes a major problem. We experienced that major problem. We experienced an entity that was so strong that it influenced the behavior of people and ruined their lives. I'm a believer in ghosts. I know there are other entities out there, such as demons and undefined entities that are created through other types of black arts. But I know ghosts. And ghosts are intelligent. They can watch you. They can read your mind. They can feed off your energy. They'll make you angry. You'll have symptoms if in your house or in the house you intend to buy. You walk in and it just doesn't feel comfortable. You don't feel at home. You may feel the little hairs on your neck, the back of your neck stand up. You may feel a hot flash of agitation for no apparent reason. You may hear a ringing in your ears that'll come on suddenly. you may feel strongly that somebody's watching you. Ghosts will toy with you and they'll play with you. And even if you're a non-believer, you'll rationalize the first types of activity. Then you'll question, as time passes, what the heck am I dealing with? You may go into denial, where you decide, no, I'm just not going to recognize this. And then eventually, you'll start to anticipate and start to question everything. Was the item moved because I moved it? Or was the item moved because this entity moved it? Did my wife move it? Eventually, you wind up walking on eggshells and living in confusion. At that point, whatever it is now dominating your life and your behavior. It's something that we will talk about in future episodes. What should you do? As a young man, I faced it with antagonism and disbelief. I actually thought that I could scare them away, yell them away, threaten them away. I was just a fool because I didn't know about the castles in England that have been haunted for 600 years and have never been able to be cleansed. You cannot make a ghost go away unless they want to. They're here for a reason. Suicide seems to be a common thread in ghostly activity. Sudden and unanticipated death is also a thread in ghostly activity, where a person died so quickly that they really don't know they're dead. Other reasons for ghostly activity can be a strong sense of domain. In our case, it was a building. It was a building built by a family. When that building was built and they built every brick of the foundation and every board to build this two-flat duplex, their dream was that they would live there, that their children would live there, that their grandchildren would live there. They had a strong sense of domain that today people don't normally have. Now, my wife and I have moved around, and we've just moved from Branson, and because I had to be closer to a trauma center hospital. We didn't think anything of it. Of our previous house, although we loved it, we had no sense of domain. It's a big difference in some of these spirits, where that they own that property. Now, I don't care if you attempt to cleanse it, or like in the Philippines, a shaman told me that in types of hauntings that are in my book, they typically burn the building down. But personally, I don't believe that works, because I believe the spirits will stay on that location until another building is built. And I've got some proof that that's true, because I have emails from people who have moved into new properties that have spiritual activity. They can question, all too frequently I hear that it may have been built on Indian burial grounds. I don't prescribe to that belief. I believe that the Native Americans buried their dead properly, and that their dead went on to a better place, much like our dead. And there's no reason for them to get upset. We tend to relocate cemeteries at will in our culture. In Chicago, they just relocated a whole cemetery and they built condominium buildings. I don't believe the people and the spirits are resident in those graves. So that's one thing that I do not believe. I will share what I do believe and what I know to be true. And that is that, yes, these spirits are or have been people at one time. They have personalities. Some of them take offense to you invading their territory and their with their sense of domain, and they will strike out at you, and they will do things. They will feel your personality. They will decide how to attack you or approach you, and they will attach themselves to you. The feelings that you'll have will be strange and foreign, because all of a sudden you'll be possibly unhappy for no apparent reason, or possibly agitated for no apparent reason. All of a sudden your relationship, I mean, one of the things you must guard is your spousal relationship and your personal relationships, because the first thing they will attempt to do is to separate you and isolate you emotionally from all else. Many, many spirits will do those things that'll cause you to question the person that you're having a relationship with, and you'll start to think negatively. It's a rare thing that Marcia and I made it through this, because most people who go through a severe haunting do not survive their relationships. In the future weeks, we'll cover some of those situations and how people deal with that. Who can you call? In 1970, we had no one to call. We went to our church, and our church reacted, they probably still react that way today, where they just don't want to acknowledge this dimension. They don't know how to deal with it, and they basically will blow you off. You know, in our case in 1970, we were told to get our heads examined and insulted. And we took a lot of skepticism and ridicule, which we still bear the scars of 45 years later. But we can talk about in future episodes today the resources you have available, who to call, what your behavior should be if you're in a situation where you can't get out of it. Now, my feeling is, and I'm not being humorous, my first instinct would be get the hell out. But a lot of people today cannot get out. They're in deep water as far as their mortgage, or they don't have the financial means to do so, much like my wife and I in 1970. So you have to learn how to deal and how to protect yourself. Stay with me and tune in to the next episode, and I'll talk a little bit about how you can protect yourself. God bless you all.